for most of the newer high-tier vehicles, because it brings about a much better difference in gameplay, and it makes missiles a lot more viable when you use the missile boat, even though it's a specifically designed vehicle for that. But if you were to give that to maybe like a BMD-4 or some other high-tier vehicle, that it would become something relevant in terms of competitive gameplay and whatnot, because you can get it off, and even though there's a warning, it's just fast enough that it gives you only just half a second to react to it, and it makes it a viable use instead of just using slinging AP rounds everywhere. You have
accuracy,
plus the speed, it's hard to dodge.
Yeah, I think really what we first do is look at, do we want to change ATGM speed for any of the current vehicles at higher tiers? Like, do we want just vehicles that are specifically ATGM boats to have, you know, the benefit of having, you know, higher ATGMs or faster ATGMs? That was like the primary thought process behind giving those faster ones, is because they rely exclusively on that. But it's certainly something that we can talk about as a team when we go and we look at how we want to rework retrofits, whether or not we want to provide a retrofit channel that would improve the speed
user
of ATGMs.
Joined your channel.
All right. Appreciate it.
No worries.
Questions coming, guys.
I got a question. You want to go for it, Spec Ops?
No. I insist, sir.
On the topic of missiles, is there anything going to be done to
user
Weasel and the Crab, because they are so pathetically useless?
Are you kidding me?
The Weasel and the Crab with missles? Yes. No.
Oh,
I'm not
okay.
Kidding.
I thought you were saying the tanks in general.
No.
The ATGM.
No, only the ATGM versions. Every time I show
user
up with one, people
channel
are like, "Wow, that thing can actually have a missile on it." Like, nobody sees it, nobody plays it, nobody knows anything about it. They're severely underpowered,
yeah.
And if you actually manage to hit stuff, you're going to be out of ammo anyways.
User joined your channel.
And the alpha's just too weak on it to be a viable option.
I think it's something that we can discuss. Like I said before, ATGM gameplay as a whole is something that we're not entirely happy with, you know, both in terms of just like how rewarding it is, the risk versus reward, etc. All that stuff is stuff that we're aware of and that we'd like to address. I'm not sure if it's specifically just a crab and a weasel issue. You know, those are two vehicles which suffer if they do opt to go for the ATGMs. But I think there is a larger discussion to be had about ATGM gameplay as a whole and what changes need to be done to make that more rewarding.
User joined your channel.
Sweet. Thank you.
User joined your channel.
Let them have both. Just kidding.
Hi guys.
User joined your
next
channel
question, please.
User
is
joined your
war
channel
going to have its own statistics page, or is it going to be a combined stat page with the PvP page that we already have?
I'm sorry, can you say that question again?
Oh, will Lords of War have its own statistics page in our dossier?
Not out the gate. They're... What was that?
You are being quiet.
I can't think of any.
My mic. Sorry about that.
I think
I can't think of any right now.
Oh, you're still super quiet.
That's not really.
You also
city better.
Joined your channel.
Yes.
Much better. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, the Lords of War statistics will be separated out to a separate tab in the dossier. That's not currently in the TPS build, but that is where they will end up.
How long is it going to take for that separate page to be implemented?
Don't have an ETA yet. It will be part of the initial season, though, so within the next few weeks.
I have a question. Will it be per player or per group?
User joined your channel.
So the tab in the dossier will be that player's individual performance in the mode. The teams also have their own team statistics that's actually accessed from the Lords of War screens. So the dossier view will still be strictly that individual player's performance.
I have an artillery question.
Besides Lords of War, what are you guys doing to excite the player base and get them back focused on PvP?
So, you know, in addition to Lords of War, you know, that's really targeting people looking for that head-to-head competition, you know, which is important and needs to be added to the game to be there. It's not the only competitive mode that we have in mind. It's just our first one that we wanted to get in. As far as PvP in general, you know, a lot of things we need to look at there have to do with sort of how do the matches play out, the actual core gameplay experience. We are working on something fairly large that is actually very targeted towards PvP. Unfortunately, I can't go into it yet. As soon as, you know, very eager to talk about it, I just can't. But there, you know, we are looking at PvP as something to where a lot of our focus is, and that isn't to say like PvE isn't important to us. We also have some big plans for PvE coming up within the next couple of patches. But PvP is actually our primary focus for a major improvement that we hope to be able to announce very soon.
Now, World of Tanks had a mode called Tank Companies back in the day, and it was a nice way of getting people together and, you know, throwing teams against other teams, you know, competitively, and getting, you know, rewarded as well, you know, with a little cash, with a little XP. I don't think it'd be too hard to program and get it into the game.
Yeah, I'm not opposed to the idea of the Tank Company stuff.
User joined your channel.
Experience in World of Tanks was that it wasn't very populated and typically was not actually accessible as a mode. There just was not enough critical mass in it, which is why I figure they moved away from it. But
that's untrue.
If your experience
extremely populated years ago.
We can't really hear you. You're extremely quiet. If you could speak up or turn yourself up.
You're talking about me?
No, the other person who was just talking.
Sorry, I probably am on the silent thing. It was extremely populated at one point. If you
User
only played the other one, the other tank game we shall not mention,
User
in the last couple
channel.
Years, yeah, they eliminated it because they had other modes they wanted to promote. So that's kind of my concern, because it was very populated for a time
Depending
being.
On what tiers you went to. Absolutes was barren most of the time.
Yeah, tier 6 was everything on that one.
So oh, tier 6 and get. Hate. But the fact of the matter is that they were very, very highly populated.
One of the things about the Lords of War system is we can actually, one of the future additions that's coming, actually we're working on it very shortly, is different types of team size support. So that we could actually have like different, you know, different conflict zones in the system would have different size of teams. So we could actually have that those large team conflict zones. And if those prove successful, you know, if people really are interested in larger 15 versus 15 teams, at that point, I think it would make a lot of sense to look at getting that into a separate supported queue.
Absolutely. We need to somehow, some way get people back to playing the game and queuing. You know, for PvP, like it was when alpha, beta, I mean, we used to have queues all day long. So, I mean, the queues have disappeared.
So, to piggyback off of that and to make another point, I know you guys had said that, you know, you can't talk about everything that's in the mix here. And that I can respect. However, I think it is important to note that the overall feeling of the player base is not a positive one directed at the development of the game, especially within the last 8 to 10 months. You know, we know it, and I think you guys know it as well. The game is at a critical point here. If these next patches fail, there may not be a game to continue on. So, you know, when we're asking these questions, you know, and we're going to get a massive pile of, well, I can't talk about it, that's not going to be a positive discussion.
Yeah, and I totally understand that. There's certain things that, like, I just can't say. I literally, like, I would love to talk about it, and I just can't talk about it. Most of what's coming up in, I'd say, the next two patches, I can talk about fairly freely. There are just a few features that would be off-limits for me as of today. Again, like I said, as soon as that changes, I'd love to be able to talk to them. I totally understand, like, the need to get that information out there, the need to show what's coming up. I think it also needs to be provided in an organized way, though, and maybe not necessarily just what I would be rattling off impromptu right now either. You know, I think maybe the message to take away from there is trying to figure out as soon as possible, coordinating with the operators as soon as possible window in which we can start sharing information about that. But that's a discussion that probably has to happen outside of here.
Keep in mind that, like, that the reason why is not just because we're mean or something. It's because, you know, things are still in flux. Things get changed, you know, pretty frequently. And, you know, we find out that after testing something works or, you know, we want to try it a different way. And so, you know, if we tell you too early that things are going to be one thing and then we change it, or, you know, even worse, if you guys get all excited and then it turns out that that can't work for some reason, then, you know, you guys are going to be disappointed and, you know, frustrated or what have you. So, you know, that's a big part of why, you know, why we don't want to talk about things too early, but we do try to be transparent whenever we can.
Transparency equals it will be fixed, or we'll tell you when we get to it. Because, I mean, for the last 6 months, that's all we've heard.
I just assumed you couldn't tell people because of developer contracts between you and the company itself.
I think we are concentrating more for some to fix some small issues, but we're not concentrating to have more team players. Now I was just to kick on a game, and I wait 10 minutes till the game was starting. So all the players are in this list now here.
I think we have somebody.
Somebody's typing.
It's HEAU. Still doing it.
Can I ask an artillery question?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, so you know how it's supposed to be a support role, and we have the illuminate shells and the smoke shells? I was wondering if there could be, like, in the future, a shell where it would reset the cap by a certain amount, or, like, cap at least a little bit for support.
If I could piggyback onto that, I know, especially with the M109, that they do have CS rounds that they could fire. That could be something that would be helpful along those lines.
Oh, what about a disabling round?
So, like, ATG, artillery in general is something that we want to, you know, we haven't really been focusing too much on artillery in a while. And I think the large part of that is because it is such a niche class. That being said, we do want to rope around back to it and sort of explore some of the more supportive features that the class can bring, you know, outside of damage, with different round types and how those rounds interact on the battlefield in more ways than just simply supporting your team by smoking them or giving them, you know, illumination on the enemy, etc. So having support rounds that sort of add some other gameplay element to the battle and you know, change up the dynamics a bit, and in that respect, you know, also contribute more towards, you know, resetting cap or being a benefit to that effort, are all things that are on the table for the class. We don't really want to, you know, we don't want to go back to, you know, just making it a pure damage class or something like that. We do want to sort of further its support role. And it's just more of orchestrating and managing the resources of the development team to set aside the time necessary to make those changes and implementations. Because you're talking about basically adding things to a class that it previously didn't have. And so, and when you're ever adding something to a class, the mechanics and what have you, those things need to be properly tested and tested for bugs, and then tested also for gameplay and making sure that it's actually fun and balanced.
Can I ask a question regarding moving, well, or at least encouraging World of Tank players, which obviously is your biggest competition, to move over to this game? And my theory, at least, is World of Tanks players feel like they have a ton invested in their account, so therefore they don't want to leave, you know, that value, all that time they have invested. And the API for World of Tanks is public, meaning you could probably set up something where where if I don't know, for X number of tanks or experience that a player had in World of Tanks, that they could be granted maybe gold or benefit, something for trying Armored Warfare, something to encourage them with their progress in World of Tanks. You could probably, similar to like XVM, where it's your progress is visible through the World of Tanks API. You could validate a user account and, I don't know, grant encourage the user in some way to come over to Armored Warfare and give it a shot. Because I just think people don't want to step away from all the progress, you know, 18,000 battles, 20,000 battles worth of effort is lost. And that's the hardest thing, I think, a lot of people to give up in World of Tanks. This is a superior game by far. But they just don't want to walk away from all that effort.
So I think there's a couple fronts to that. First of all, we have done such promotions in the past, so I don't know if you guys, know this, but we did some promotions in Europe where we gave bonuses to people switching over from World of Tanks. It's definitely something that we, continue to explore further, because like you say, it's an obvious audience that we want to tap into. I think part of that is making sure that, there's competitive modes. I think Lords of War is a great first step for that. But, part of it is also letting people know and like you say, convincing people that this is an investment worthy of their time. And I think people can play both. So I don't think it's, one or the other. But I do agree with you that, that we could probably offer incentives to people switching games, within reason. So that is definitely something that we are exploring. User disconnected from your channel.
And one thing I think also it's important to also note is that, we want to offer a big enough difference in gameplay where it's something that World of Tanks players feel like if they move over, not only are they, they're not having to just start over, but they're experiencing something new, right? They're not just experiencing World of Tanks' modern version. And while there are obviously a ton of similarities between the two games, those are things that we're gradually working to sort of get away from and offer both familiar experiences and new experiences, right? Like, if you want to bring someone over from a game that they're heavily invested in, you want to offer them a similar experience, but one that is also new and different in enough ways to really feel refreshing, right? So that's, from a development standpoint, that's sort of what our goal is to continue making these improvements in these areas that really incentivize players to say, hey, this isn't just what with a new skin on it. This is a new game mode, or this is a new way of approaching, tank gameplay, both from a modern spin and also just from a gameplay perspective. Those are all things that we're working to do to sort of incentivize players to at least give us a try. Like this is more than just like WOT 2.0 or something like that. This is AEW. It's its own game with its own unique features, and that'll only continue. The gap between the two will only continue to broaden the longer the game is in development, really.
Can I piggyback on that? Go ahead. Yeah, I just recently started. I've been World of Tanks for X number of years as well. And my clan from there asked me to come over and try you guys out. Well, I was pleasantly surprised to find out that you started me off at level 3 instead of 1, whereas World of Tank would have started you at 1. So I do appreciate that.
That's because tiers 1 and 2 were eliminated from the user queue. Joined your channel.
I think there's an opportunity to sell those differences better, whether it's through videos are probably the better way to do it, but emphasizing the differences in some of your promotional material is useful, because I think there's a lot of World of Tankers that have a general idea. They think they know what Armored Warfare is, but until they actually play it, they don't know. I think there is an assumption that it's simply a modern version of a similar thing, and some of the differences of guided missiles and how artillery is not as, pardon my French, messed up as it is in the other game. It's like, in fact, I don't know. It seems like the salesmanship could be upped a notch or two.
Can I add on?
Could I?
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely good.
I agree that there's a lot to be said for trying to woo the World of Tanks player. I myself am a former World of Tanks player with probably over 50,000 battles. And if you're going to do that, I would caution you to stagger the reward for that participation and come check it out, but have it be graduated so that there's a continued incentive for that player to stay. Don't just give them the gold brick up front. Make them work for it a little bit. So stagger it so that it's tied to X number of games played, or you know, they've logged in so many times. I wouldn't say log in, that's just too easy, but incentivize it so that there's some benefit to Armored Warfare, the player base, over a longer period of time rather than just come check out our game.
Like a month of premium instead of just here's a big lump sum up front.
Roger.
Yeah. If I could piggyback on top of that.
Bring people over is competitive play. You get competitive play over here and you're going to get people coming back in swarms. Until
that's right, and that's why
offering people gold here and there.
User joined your channel.
You know, you're just going to give a bunch of people a little bit of gold, and then they're going to do the same thing. They're going to play a little while, and then they're going to leave. Competitive play is where you need to head.
I totally agree with that, because you're basically right now like the first girlfriend after a bad divorce. You know,
the rebound.
So you gotta yeah, you're the rebound. You gotta bring something to the table.
Right, and like I said earlier, that's why part of the initiative of getting World of Tanks players interested in Armored Warfare, you know, in addition to World of Tanks, is competitive mode.
User
and that's, you know,
channel.
Why we're really excited for Lords of War. You know, we really do think that will be a great first competitive mode. There are more coming, you know, in the future, but yeah.
Takoyaki. I have one thing else, though, to go off of what Frosty said. Considering that there are kind of three teams on the NA server that kind of have been really, really dominant. Five, to be fair. Five teams that are really, really dominant. It is really, really shitty for the new teams trying to get in that there is no way that they can get prize support. Like, because prizes are... And I understand that you guys have some sort of metric or something to what kind of prize support you give out. But when there's only prizes for the top three teams, it's really... It doesn't incentivize the new teams to want to build and do something and actually come into competitive play when they just get rolled in the Armored Warfare League stuff. And that's not Will's fault or Post's fault. It's that there's not enough incentive to get those players in and keep coming back.
Well, spec it's on that, I mean, is prize is really the way to go? I mean, you look at, like, the tank game that we should not mention, whatever.
You can say World of Tanks, guys. It's not a problem.
Yeah, okay. So World of Tanks, they do team battles, they do strongholds, there's no prizes for these, it's just competitive gameplay, and teams of all skill level jump into that just because they love to play together, right? So, I mean, I think this is more the Lords of War and more just the competitive gameplay that we need to get the newer teams into the mix.
Yeah, just like a Friday night fight night and stuff like that. I mean, you got people, you got 15 on 15 and people can't play, and, you know, and there's no prizes.
Hey, have you thought about using for the Lord of
anything?
Have you thought about the Lord of War system that to reward players better by going in with random teams instead of organized teams? That way, it gets people into playing randomly.
Yeah,
the competitive. I can tell you,
you're back to pub matches.
Player.
Yeah, you're back to pub matching.
Exactly. Would not be interested in that at all.
All right, that's just to weigh in. The primary focus for Lords of War is organized team play. We are supporting solo play as sort of a, sometimes that's necessary just to populate the queue if not everyone can fill the full team, but the focus of Lords of War is organized head-to-head team competition.
Hey Jojo, you have a question?
Yes.
Ask?
And sorry, before we move on to the next question, I just also want to speak to the fact about doing tournaments specifically catered towards like newer teams and newer battalions and whatnot, like the newer players. So that's actually one thing that you know, I reached out to Armored Warfare Leagues as well as some players out in Europe that were organizing tournaments as well. And we've actually tried to organize some tournaments for newer players, so setting the tournament at lower tiers, not as grand prizes, but still worthy prizes and whatnot.
And, you know, we ran those for almost 2 months. We did find that it was very much a lot of the higher competitive teams that you guys are referring to were still participating in that. And obviously, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, they're open tournaments, of course, and it would be wrong for us to say, oh, you know, you five teams can't compete in this tournament. But, like, we did have tournaments specifically that we wanted to cater towards newer players, and we just found, you know, they didn't quite work. You know, so we're not doing as much of them anymore. There's still kind of the mini tournaments and whatnot that are still geared towards newer players. The fight nights come up some, but I mean, if you guys have suggestions on other activations outside of Lord of War, because Lord of War is going to be very much, you know, catered towards the stuff as Rich and Michael were talking about there. But we're very open to that type of feedback, guys. I mean, especially if you have an idea that you think that you can, a kind of event. It may not have to be a tournament or a league or anything like that, but if you think of an event that maybe we could help support with prizing or advertising or something like that, that would kind of incentivize newer players to come in, definitely reach out to us. We're happy to support anything, any ideas and stuff like that, because I mean, we've wholeheartedly agree with you. I mean, having, you know, high tier competition for the kind of the elder battalions that have been around for a while that are, you know, exceptionally good, and then having kind of lower tier, and I say tier and just kind of like experience level, for those sort of players, if we can do both and we can do both well, I mean, we should absolutely do that. So you guys have ideas, suggestions, reach out to us and we'll do everything we can to support you.
Hey, Joji. Wait, guys. Joji, you had a question you've been trying to ask.
Okay, so a lot of my friends are from Pacific area, right? For example, Philippines.
Feedback.
Jinx. Your mics.
So a lot of my friends are from, well, my clanmates are from like Pacific area, like Philippines or Indonesia, these areas, right? And their computers aren't the best. So how World of Tanks, it plays decent on their computers. Armored Warfare is like really resource heavy on their PCs, right? So if there's any chance the developers can lower down the specs or make it easier to play Armored Warfare on their shitty PCs, let's just say, it'll be really great. At the same time, my friends from Rahab, the Japanese clan, by the time they log into Armored Warfare, like after their work is over, there aren't any PvP matches to play in. It's like PvP's like dead for them at their current time zone. So, if you can put in like bots,
about the NA PvP queue is a huge issue already.
I'll answer his question real quick. Obviously, the NA queue is an issue, and that's something that's a bigger sort of topic of discussion. But specifically talking about performance issues, so in Dot 16, we're giving you the ability to disable shadows in game, not in Garage, because if you disable them in Garage, it looks terrible. But in game, you'll be able to disable them. And we've also gone through and made some map optimizations, which should reduce hitching. What I mean by hitching is basically like major dips in FPS. So you go from like 40 and then it dips down to like 15 randomly and then it goes back up. That's the first sort of set of optimizations that we're really pushing forwards. We're going to have more to come in the next couple patches that, again, are more geared towards the lower end spec machines that are really struggling. Of course, you know, World of Tanks is a completely different engine, you know, and we have CryEngine for Armored Warfare, and CryEngine is to an extent resource intensive, but we are working very hard to ensure that min spec computers are able to play the game at a acceptable frame rate, right, and actually enjoy the game. So you can definitely tell them for Dot 16 they can disable shadows and there should be less hitching. And then you can tell them that in the future patches, there'll be some additional optimization tweaks as well that are going to be pretty nice.
So a question about the NA population servers as well. I mean, obviously, you guys are aware of it and you're, you know, doing whatever you can about it. In the future, whether it be through the game release or after Lords of War, whatever it is, if we get an influx in new players, is there any strategy or anything to get them to higher tiers quicker? I mean, I just see that we're just going to have a, you know, a shitload of threes and fours playing the game, and then no fives and sixes. So, you know, anybody that's playing the game and wants to get in queues relatively fast is just going to have to drop to threes and fours.
It'd be like a friend invite, like free, like a premium free friend invite, like 30-day premium time.
I think you need to drag
something,
the players
something
towards
along those lines, just to accelerate their trap, you know, their grind, I guess you'd say, a little bit faster to get them in higher tiers.
Can I jump in on that? One of the dangers of doing that is you have the same thing that happens when you have a bunch of people who play PvE exclusively and then suddenly get their tier 10 tanks and then try to play PvP. What you have is people who either, because they haven't ground through the game, haven't learned how to play properly. And
right.
So what does that do to the player base?
I think what you need to do is
it's great if you want to run around in Seal Club all night, but
user joined your channel.
What does it do to help the overall health of the community?
You need to drive new players towards clans. You need to drive the new players towards clans so they go in there and they get some help, you know, with simple stuff like, you know, where to aim and just very simple stuff, how to play the game. That way they're not going to feel so alone if there could be some sort of
one
instructional clan or...
Can I say something?
Yes, you can.
Thank
Floor's
you.
Yours.
I played EVE Online for 3 years and participated in the Alliance Tournament. So if anybody's played EVE, they know how big that is. Now, the thing is I belong to CAS, which is Center for Advanced Studies, which is a new player corporation. And our intent there, the reason that us people that stayed there, was to retain players into the game. And the biggest way to do that is whether you guys are in a clan or not, to take new people under your wing and work with them. And that's all I had to say. You have to do it yourself, guys.
Right. The way to do that is put them in a clan.
There's no incentive.
Works with them.
A lot of people have a problem with joining clans because there's nothing for clans to do. We really need endgame to make clans a thing.
If I may recommend something, I know World of Tanks has sort of a Clan Wars style and Strongholds thing. Is there any possibility we could add in something like that in order to make it more diverse and make people want to join these battalions in game more?
That's something I mentioned
Lords of
before.
War.
No.
Lords of War is a bit different than endgame content on a clan-based system.
Yes, but Lords of War is going to be that thing that bridges that gap and brings people and socializes them. So I think that's what you're trying to look for, and that's why that system's being provided. Yes, we're also working on a Clan Wars-like service as well, but again, that's going to just attract a certain amount of people, and what the game needs to have those people come from being complete noobs to being somewhat competitive in like a Lord of War mode and then being transferred into Clan Wars. Yes, we could get some high level Clan Wars people to potentially come over and play directly in the Clan Wars, but you won't have the people feeding into the whole system. Obviously it's a very complicated situation that we're in, but let me just say that we need to hit these things all at the same time, right? I mean, we know that there's an advertisement component. We know that there's a feature component. We know that there is a partnership component, and we need to deal with these things and align them all at the same time. So Lord of War is one of those first opportunities to try to align some of these things together. And it's also going to count on you guys as well to, when we do that advertisement, when we launch Lord of War, I have complete forums of people complaining that the NA server is dead or the PvP queue is dead. If each one of those people were just logging into the game and playing instead of saying that it was dead, it wouldn't be dead.
You realize, Josh, hold on. Do you realize, Josh, that we generally go to the forums to bitch about this stuff as we're sitting in PvP queue?
So it's just one at a time.
If you want to sit here and say we're a problem for something like that, I would actually point you to the numbers of people who are actually playing. And that is the problem.
So going back to...
I don't know if it's doable or if it's even been discussed before, since it's my first time participating in one of these conversations with the devs directly. Have you thought about doing incentivizing like a particular tier on a particular day of the week? So give, you know, 20% additional credit income, since credits seem to be the biggest grind, the hardest thing to come by. Reputation.
That's another interesting thing about the Lord of War system, is that it specifically targets particular queues, tiers at particular times. So that is exactly what that does, and we're going to obviously be offering what I feel are pretty good prizes and incentive for people to play Lords of War. So I think it's our first step to, you know, getting that PvP crowd going again, specifically on the NA server.
Going one step further than that, incentivizing lower tiers, incentivizing people who have already progressed to higher tiers into the lower tiers again, is something even beyond Lords of War that we're looking at. You know, we do have like the daily challenge system. So it's not inconceivable that you could get a daily challenge. In fact, multiple people could get daily challenges where it says, hey, play 3 games at tier 5, you know, and then that's how you get one of your loot boxes. So using the daily challenge system to sort of promote players who have already gotten higher tiers to go back to those lower tiers is certainly one avenue that we can take in addition to Lords of War, in order to get people playing at a specific tier on a specific day.
Just to further complement that, those two points as well, is in terms of the events that we do, so like the Summer Heat that we did, there's opportunity there to incentivize people to play in a specific tier, and you're going to see that kind of come into play in future events that we're doing, starting as early as next month, where there's going to be further incentives in terms of actual significant rewards to be able to play at certain tiers. And so those three things in combination are kind of steps in the right direction. So wanted to throw that one in there too.
So
I have one other thing. Something there real quick.
Go ahead.
I know there are certain clans and players who have currently been helping with the PvP queues. For example, in Reddit there, we've been doing sync drops at least 2 nights of the week.
User joined your channel.
Looking to see if any other players would like to sit there and do sync drops, but contacting those clients has been a bit of a challenge.
Okay, so to specifically speak to that point, you know, one of the things that us from a community team standpoint, one of the things that I've done to challenge my team here is to be able to put a little bit more of a spotlight on the battalions feature. So, I mean, you guys talked a little bit about how battalions are important in the game, that players need to get into battalions, and you know, whether that means whether some more additional battalion features need to come in, that's on the game side. But on the community standpoint side, one of the things that we're going to be doing on our team is actually giving a lot more exposure to battalions, and the fact that battalions exist, and giving more players more tools to be able to find battalions, talk, communicate with those battalions, and actually, you know, participate in that sort of aspect of the community. And, you know, we've got, you know, a number of different, you know, ideas that we're kind of going to start launching into, you know, as early as July. And then, you know, the guys that from the Reddit crew, I mean, you guys, you know, we were in contact with you almost, you know, what, daily these days. And so, I mean, that's definitely, I see that as a priority. I totally agree with you from there. And I think that, you know, coming up into this next month, you're going to see some improvements there as well, in terms of just getting more eyes on the battalion scene within the community.
And that being said, on the
we did
the
with
Reddit,
that is, you guys saw we had an interview with a battalion
User
already,
joined your channel.
And I've reached out to a couple of battalion leaders to get more interviews. So that's part of the way we're going to be helping drive people to battalions, is putting those, you know, who are we, right out on the front page, right out on the launcher, so people can see who you are and come find you.
Yeah. And we're also going to be revamping the battalions forum.
We're going to keep hammering away at it. Thank you.
And that being said, thank you very much to the Reddit again for doing that. I think the sync drops, along with community streams going on at the same time, we've
I feel like we've seen success during those periods of time. You know, people are able to get games in those tiers. I obviously didn't mean to offend anyone by saying, you know, anything about, you know, the NA situation on PvP queues. What I am trying to say is, by working together and bringing more people into these sync drops, I think we'll be able to see some forward momentum going forward.
Hey, I have a question about how, I mean, on the European server, do you not have a problem with PvP queues? Is that true or false?
It depends on the time of day, obviously. So let me just describe a little bit the difference between the NA and the EU server. The EU server is very compressed in the time zones that people are logging in. Generally, everyone's in the European time zone, so really 1 to 2 time zones that the majority of people come in and log in. So even with, you know, maybe say they have double the population in NA, in actuality, for logging in and getting a PvP game in, their CCU is much higher because they all log in at the same time. In the NA server, we stretch everywhere from Brazil, which is, you know, even farther out from the East Coast, you know, all the way over to what, Japan, right? So our CCU is spread across, I don't know what, how many time zones, 14 different time zones. So it's just harder for NA, and this is true for World of Tanks because I work there as well. It's until they got the Asian server, it's harder to get a critical mass because you need so many more players for the NA server to work. So we understand the issue, and we'll try to put in multiple time frames to work for different prime times than the NA server. But we obviously need a lot more players to make it work.
Can we get a better idea when the Lord of Wars patch is going to hit? Is it 1 week? Is it 2 weeks? Is it 3 weeks? A lot of my guys are coming at me, and we just don't know.
Well, we're going to get some practice games in beforehand, but it's going to come between, we're looking at right now between update 16, which is, you know, intermittent within a week or so, and point 17, which, you know, we've gone out to, I don't know, but we're at like six week time frame on patches these days. So, you know, I would say the 3 to 4 weeks, but it all depends on how some of this initial testing goes and what's shown on the RU server, because we are going to launch it there first, because they have extremely a lot more population than us, so they can kill some of the problems that the mode may have.
Hey, I have 2 or 3 questions about Matchmaker. You guys are happy with us doing sync drops, but is there anything you can do to optimize this Matchmaker so that when people are doing sync drops, they're not going to constantly force the 6v6 kind of matches popping up?
Yes, we could change the matchmaking for those particular time frames when we know sync drops are, and widen it out even up to 30.
Yeah. Add like maybe 10 seconds to the matchmaker before it launches a 6v6. That would help a lot in terms of, because we do countdowns and people ready up at the same time pretty much.
Sure.
I have another question, but go ahead.
I actually have a thing. ACH usually does something like tier roulette, where we just put one guy in the queue and see who has the most amount of tanks and what tier.
Yeah, I came
and
up
then
with
we
that.
Drop all of their, then we drop all of our tanks in that tier.
It's that helps, but you can still get into a match of 12 people.
66. It just launches
constantly.
It.
Yeah,
anyways,
we find it the easiest to sync drop with. That's what we do.
Right, that's one thing. And then another thing. No. With the introduction of the 6v6 PvP matches, is it possible that we could get PvE maps for those mini matchups? I mean, these maps are so big that 6v6 just doesn't make sense anymore on these huge maps.
User disconnected from the
Highwall. I completely agree with that, Highwall. It's just a cap race on 6v6.
Right, so it would be nice if we had PvE maps for 6v6. Do you guys have any thoughts on that?
Technically, I just don't think you can do that.
unfortunately, the maps, like, they may look the same, but, like, the underlining tech in a PvE map is completely different than in PvP. I mean, we essentially take a PvP map sometimes, redo a lot of the geometry, and then build it from the ground up with a lot of different triggers and other underlining tech, I guess you could say, that makes it run as a PvE map. So it's actually a pretty decent amount of work to get it to actually behave as a PvP map. And obviously they're not really balanced for PvP in mind, so like one side will be like very lopsided, you know, so to speak.
Right.
Just ask the question on that, just to follow up. What would the thought be? I mean, I know standard is awkward on those larger maps with the smaller teams. If it was all encounter only, would that be an improvement in your guys' mind, or
pick the right maps for it?
It would eliminate the whole cap race on high walls specifically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the central issue is the maps themselves. Would it be intensive, Spunky or Red, to just, if you're going to run 6v6, if the game is going to be a 6v6, then that the map high wall or any other big map like that is just not an option for a map in the rotation.
As of today, there's nothing for us to be able to do that. I don't think that would be difficult to implement, though. I think that's a conversation we should have internally on this side. I think that's a really good idea.
I can actually, with the tools available, Rich, right now, ability to do that, I believe. So,
but can you define the maps based upon the team sizes that Matchmaker's putting together?
No, not based on how many people are on there, but I could definitely reconfigure it so that we have encounters and we could actually remove maps, and I can actually go back and increase the max size again. One of the reasons why we toned down how many players were in a match was because you would have a better chance of. Would you rather wait another 5-10 minutes to try to get 14 or 16 or 20 or maybe never get into a match, or would you rather play a match, come back out again, and play another small match? And it actually lines up fairly well with Lord of War, and this is something that we're going to have to take a look at. That mode is being played on the 5-7. You know, kind of range, maybe even 5-10, somewhere along there. So a lot of these maps, we have to determine which ones are going to be good for that mode. So this is actually going to be a good test for us, I believe, the NA server.
One last question about that, to clarify. You said PvE, PvE maps are not really designed for PvP, but so you're saying those PvE maps will never show up in custom matches? Because I would love to see the PvE maps.
He said
maps
specifically that, like, the spawns and the triggers and how the map is coded and scripted is not supported for.
Well, I'd love to see that stuff, like, rebalanced so that we could use them in terms of these small mini tournaments, like the 4v4 stuff. Some of those maps might actually work, and it shouldn't be too hard to reconfigure some of those things since those things are already created.
I don't think.
It's more in lines with the actual map balance.
Here's another question, Red, or Spunk. What about just cutting a section of the map out? It's going to be 6v6 or 8v8.
Start with a large PvP map that's already coded for PvP with the entity spawns.
And just eliminate half of it.
To cut, cut some off. Like, in the custom match window, just make a square, and that's it.
Anyways, just something to think about, I guess.
Is there any way that we can get you guys tank ideas that we would like to see be put into the game? Because
yes, there's a whole form on it, I believe.
Oh, there is?
LAV25. Put it in, please.
I'd like to see the MBT variant of the Bradley, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, we know that everybody has desires for which tank they'd like to see in the game. We definitely do take that into account. In the past, I have created reports for, you know, the developers and for the publisher to, you know, figure out which tanks we should add to the game next. But we need to hear from you guys for that. So we do have a suggestions forum, and you know, if you guys post there, we definitely read it.
Okay.
And you know, if a lot of people,
He's getting it installed.
May I suggest somebody something?
Hot miking.
Is it possible that the NA PvP queue could be limited to tier 6 for the time being, except especially during the week? Because one of the problems we're suffering right now is that people are jumping into 7s or 8s and just like getting in this constant high tier or higher and higher tier. I don't know what you really want to call it, but
it's an arms race in the tier.
It's an arm race in the tier. And one of the problems with that in the 6v6 is it is fine to fight 5s and 6s against one another, right? But having bagels or ERCs or any of the tier 5s having to start fighting Chally spam is going to draw or drive away new players really fast.
The bigger issue is the fact that higher tiers are woefully balanced at present. So like it's like
of that is changing with 16 and 0.17, right? So that is something that we are addressing.
To kind of back up a little bit to the conversation, about the up tier battles and just a little bit about kind of how I'm thinking about that is, I feel it would be beneficial to the game to actually expand the viable range that vehicles can fight. And what I mean by that is I feel like there does have to be that sense of progression and vehicles, you know, you'd expect them to get a bit stronger as you go up in the tiers. I think that curve is too steep. And that's just been it's kind of been an ongoing issue that we really want to correct and kind of tone that down. The power curve gets a little bit, not quite exponential, but it is, it gets pretty ridiculous once you start getting past the tier 6 to the 7 on up. To where just like you said, you know, fighting a tier 7 with a tier 5 is just a joke. You don't really have any relevance in that fight. I'd really like to take a look at it and this actually has multiple goals here. But the idea is like if a tier 7 versus a tier 5 actually was an interesting fight and not just a complete joke, it also means that we can actually get away with a wider tier spread in the matchmaking, which is actually beneficial for North America, because we could actually have, you know, if all of a sudden now like 4-6 is a fun fight and not just a slaughter, well then, you know, now we can start throwing those tiers in more regularly against each other and not expect that to be a negative experience for players. But that kind of translates all the way up the curve, right? So I do think like
user joined
the question
channel.
Is valid, like it sucks, like why do you want to be in a tier 5 and then have to go into a match with tier 7s? It's just going to be miserable. I think we should solve that problem as an actual direction in terms of overall balance.
Sure. And that makes sense, right? Dangerous. Like everybody wants the curve on damage and pen and all that to be decreased, right? The power curve. At the moment, we have a problem with sevens, everyone jumping into sevens to club fives, and that's gonna really, really make people not want to continue playing this game. And I think if like Monday through Thursday it was locked at 6 and below, you're gonna have way better fights, more consistent fights, and more people will want to stay.
How can you stay if you don't have a tier 6 and you're a new player, you'll get 0 games in, right?
I didn't say no. Locked 6 as max tier to play. So you can't
max tier.
9 and 10, but you can play 1 through 6.
That's actually kind of a variation on the theme of what I was thinking, which would be to do something to incentivize folks to play a particular tier, mid-tier or even lower tier, to try to make sure that there are not just a bunch of noobs trying to fight it out, but hopefully a couple of experienced players in there that if they're paying attention, they can go, hey, that seemed to work. Maybe I should try to emulate that and learn by osmosis. Or not everybody has the benefit of being able to go and watch, you know, Spishak or any of the other really top-end streamers to learn the game. Now, hopefully, as the population grows, those options will still be there, but anything you can do at this stage, train the influx of new players so that they learn how to be at least proficient, basically raise the bar for the entire community, you'll have a much more satisfied player base, and they'll want to stay with the game because they are not only seeing the progression in tank that they're driving, but they're also seeing the progression in their skills improve in the game, and they're having a better experience as they go forward.
I have a suggestion to that end.
Now,
I have a question.
Go ahead.
I'd like to hold on a second. I'd like to reiterate that, and Reddit can support you guys in that aspect, but we need other people to actively queue for PvP. I mean, I can bring 35, 40 guys, and you see all you do is see is Reddit and PvP. We need to see the other clans.
Well, that's not
that's
entirely
all I
true.
Play all day. Come on, man.
The HCH, we've got 15 to 20 people in there every night that we do our own sync drops.
Yeah,
I know Badger brings in the few of us in Dunger that actually do play. Whenever we see these happen, we jump in.
I mean, I feel like this is something where the community team can really step up and help you guys out and, you know, facilitate communication between you and make sure that you're all in touch with each other. And that way, when one of you is doing this, and you can let the others know, and then everybody will know, oh, this is what's going on at this time. And then, you know, I feel like that's just a communication issue that we can definitely help resolve.
To address some of that, you know, this will, you know, Armored Warfare League, and I don't speak on behalf of my.com or Obsidian, but, you know, we're already doing stuff with Fight Night, so that's training new players. We've also got Historical Battle starting soon, so we're doing some of that training, and Sir Havoc from England is starting the Armored Warfare Academy, just like he did with the WOT Academy, and that's starting later this summer. So all that stuff is going to be addressed, at least from the community end, to help out everything.
Second thing.
Question on that, though. All right, go ahead, Zara.
Oh, I just wanted to add on the whole tier 6 maximum. Is there a way you can make it so you separate that, instead of saying that you can't play your tier 7s and above during the weekdays, make it so that tier 7s can't get into 6s and belows? Say that tier 7s can only fight from that point onwards.
Maybe later, but right now that would just separate the queue even harder.
Yeah, we can't take any separation of the queue.
And again, those tiers are so imbalanced, nobody really wants to play them aside from the people who have 10s.
Question.
Again, guys, you get, like, the thing you should really, like, consider is you're thinking very narrowly in the sense that, like, how do we address this issue this very moment, right? When talking, like, with Red Fox, you know, when we're discussing making larger balance changes, which we are still planning. Like, this isn't something that we're just, like, throwing out right now. This is something that we are planning. By addressing it as a whole, then you sort of get rid of these sort of one-off solutions that are necessary to, or potential solutions, I should say, to sort of balance out tiers by, you know, restricting tiers 5 and 6 from playing with tier 7, potentially splitting the PvP there, you know, and making these sort of, like hacky, I would say, solutions when we could address it as a whole.
Spunky, I think we all understand that. We're just trying to put come up with a band-aid so we don't uninstall the game.
Yeah.
The other thing is,
that totally makes sense. That it's
yeah. Well, just hold on.
Something in place.
Go back to what Will was talking, or go back to Frytag and saying that the community can come together and kind of create these like fight night type things and all that. And then that's fantastic. But what are the means of advertising and marketing these organizations or these organized nights? Because, like, you know, most people in this team, people know that I'm an avid player, and the first couple of fight nights that we did, I didn't even know about them until they were already done.
We can put them on social media. We can also advertise in-game so people that are in the PvE queue at the time can say, oh, now's the time I should log in.
Can we not get anywhere on the launch flag? Because every single player that ever plays the game sees that first, right? And that's my first source of information
for
the
game. Well, you only see it when you start the game the first time.
Well, I mean, but everybody sees that, though.
Yeah, just add it as one of the four, like, news items or whatever for the day.
Or increase that to 6 and, you know, add that.
Or, yeah, just give it its own little, hey, tonight you have the so-and-so.
Like, yeah, you could have a special window that would just be for, you know, announcements for daily events that are going on. So when you log in, you see that. So today's daily event is Fight Night. There's a PvP tournament this day. And getting
calendar.
Then
like have that off to the left-hand side or something, you know, just like a banner or a border or something.
Well, I know on Wednesdays and Fridays when Reddit is doing sync drops and stuff, we actually do have an open TS there for players. And I know if kind of
right, but if nobody knows about it,
Exactly.
That's a good place to put streams. A lot there.
Most of the clans are willing to come together and do this, and a lot of them are already being very, very proactive about doing so. I just think we're limited on how many of the actual, forgive my bad language, pubbies and new players we're getting the word out to here. I think a lot of this fight night and stuff is just inter-clan. You know, we're not actually reaching out and getting new players in it.
That is a very valid point. Promotion for what we're doing. If that's what your next goal is to get us, you know, putting the Band-Aid on it for now, all of us, getting us all together to meet, promotion for all of us, what we're doing, the fight night, the sync drops, the everything is going to be the next step.
Can I add something to this?
Go ahead.
Oh, okay,
now,
so...
You guys, sorry. You guys are talking a lot about PvP, and I play it. It's not my favorite part of Armored Warfare. And there's a bunch of people in my clan or battalion that don't play a whole lot of PvP. We do play, and when we do play, we play as together, as a platoon. But when we play the PvE side, the map rotation, yes, it does change every 5 minutes, but it doesn't change to the point where we're getting different maps every 15, 20 minutes. We're getting... Every 15, 20 minutes, we're getting a repeat of the map we just played.
The same two or three missions all day because of the length it takes to play it? Is that what you're referring
right.
to?
Right.
Yeah, it's kind of annoying.
And that's great, but at least the PvE side are getting matches on a consistent basis and not waiting.
Well, hold on. Let's not
he's
get
not comparing PvP. He's just
we never got an answer. We never really got a response from the MyCom guys about
but I'm
marketing
not done.
The...
I'm not done. But when we go in as a full platoon, one thing to help increase the player base would be to fix that particular problem. Another thing would be to give the people that do a five-man platoon or even a three-man platoon, we get a bonus for platooning as it is.
You get the same bonus.
You get the same bonus. It's a rep bonus. You get the same bonus for platooning as a one-man, as a two-person platoon versus a five-person platoon. You want to increase the platoons, you give a larger bonus for the five-person platoons. That would help increase the camaraderie.
But I don't see how you can compare the PvE to PvP platoons where the PvE side is relatively healthy, where the PvP side needs players. And if you start platooning, and we've tried this, three-man platoons does not work anymore. You cannot get matches.
Yeah, you do need to fix
it. It just the load on the NA server. It just doesn't take it.
Right. I understand the PvP side of it, but if you get new people or people that I've had four or five people in my platoon that do not play PvP, just because every time they go into PvP, they get the same map. And to them, it seems like it's the same people or the same tier tanks that come
they
picking
do.
On them.
Probably the that's all that's in the queue.
All right, hold on. Are they dying really quickly? Because they cycle, the maps cycle quickly. Are they dying really quickly and sucking at the game?
I honestly don't know how they particularly play PvP. He said
User
he tried
disconnected
it,
from your channel.
And one of them says he tries it. I've got a couple people that love playing PvP, but they still play PvE with us. We've got a couple that they don't like PvP, maybe because of the dynamic of it. It's a faster paced dynamic, and yes, they do die quickly.
But okay, regardless,
we can look
That's what I was saying. It's clearly something that we can look into on map rotation times for PvE.
As a side note, for PvP, I guess variety, could you add maybe like a middle of the game kind of bonus to maybe like to increase damage for all, like 10% or something? I don't know. Like just like, oh, you capture the supply crate or something? I don't know. Just like an encounter mode.
It's embarrassing.
I don't know.
May I say something?
Hold on, let's get back
to my point real quick. What are our options on marketing for the inner community? Because the word is getting out.
Right, so we can do...
How do clans talk to each other in a more efficient manner when they're doing something?
I mean, we do have the battalion forum. Aside from that, we can reach out to the different battalions. We're already doing that as part of our sort of interview series. We can do that, and, you know, as well for the purpose of making sure the battalions are in touch with each other. And then, you know, when we do these kind of events, we can definitely do a better job of posting in-game announcements to let everybody know, hey, that, you know, there'll be sync drops at this and this time, you know, get into the queue at these tiers or what have you. So these are all things we can do. And we're also going to talk tomorrow. We just chatted about this on Skype to see what we can do with the launcher, because we should have the capability of pushing more news there.
Then we should also talk to the clans to see when they want to do these things, and we can actually put them on a calendar so that people can see them at a longer distance, right?
Maybe put the calendar on the front page.
I mean, if the entire gaming community knew that, like, anyway. I don't know, Tuesdays and Thursdays and Saturdays were BP night between certain hours, and everyone just started aligning to it, or whatever those are, I think we would at least have a few nights of the week that collectively pretty much everyone who plays the game could actually play PvP without all the crappy waits.
Can I say back?
At least within the NA time zones.
Can I ask a couple questions?
Well, hold on. I wanted to throw in one other point, too. User disconnected from your channel. One of the things that we could also do is have more, you know, we do these, these fireside chats once every month. There's nothing stopping us from all of us who are the most active in this conversation here is meeting on a daily basis here or every couple of days or at least on a weekly basis here on TeamSpeak or somewhere. I mean, we're all here, we're on TeamSpeak, and every few days, let's get together and talk about what's coming up and how we can efficiently promote it and making sure that everybody's on the same page. And, as we continue to meet, we'll bring more and more people in and just kind of let it snowball from there, right? And so I think that just an increased communication just amongst ourselves to start off with is a great stepping stone. And then, once we're all on the same page, it's up to us to kind of promote that a lot more. But it's also, like what Kevin was talking about, in-game announcements on all of our social channels, actually using the events on our Facebook page. So like we don't really use events, but we can start creating events and actually inviting our audience to it. And then as we continue to go, that's we're doing what we can, and then you guys are also doing your outreach as well too, talking with players in game and just continue to spread the word. So I think those are some additional steps that we can do to kind of grow, gain momentum on this, as you mentioned.
Can I say something now?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, so according to the people from Rahab, which is the Japanese, the only Japanese AW clan so far, they told me that the reason why not many people want to play AW in Japan is because they like old World War II tanks more than modern tanks. So. If you can put in some more
There's
historical
the game for
tanks
them
from...
then.
It's just an excuse, dude.
There's a game for them if they want to play World War II tanks.
Well, yeah. Yes, I know.
There's two games,
that's,
actually.
That's not yes, really I know.
And there's also more World War II tanks coming into the lower tiers, like the IS-7.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say.
Like, AMX.
If you can bring in more older tanks, too. Not too old, obviously. Like, after World War II tanks, too. Like, I don't know, early Cold War era. To armored warfare, maybe that would bring in
a lot of those people would still prefer World War II tanks, so they're it's not of much use to us.
It's not
and, already it's a bunch of accounts. There's already a bunch of pre-Cold War tanks in the game as it is.
They don't want to leave their accounts behind, that's what it really is. It's just an excuse, man. I've talked to many people about this.
That's good feedback nonetheless. Let's not chastise them for providing some feedback there.
M50 Sherman, Super Sherman, maybe something like that.
More tanks are coming, and there's a forum for that.
Right, sorry.
Yeah, guys.
The Japanese players, they like RPG games a lot, so if you can put some sort of like massive RPG elements in Armored Warfare, that would be good. Like a very big PvE map.
Like a loot system where crew and...
Hey, guys, can you guys let him finish his comment, please? You guys are interrupting him. Let him finish his comment.
Please let him talk.
Like, if you could put some sort of, like, If you can make, like, a certain...
Lock. Hot mic, Black Horse.
I'm deaf. I'm fucking deaf.
Black Horse, thank you.
Hello? Okay.
There we go.
My ears are now bleeding, thanks.
So what the Red Hat players are really asking for is some sort of, very big, very, like, open map sort of, game mode where you can play like a where you can place the game like an RPG game such as Fallout or Final Fantasy. It's a little bit weird, I know the concept, but if you can make
isn't
it
isn't that War Thunder though?
No, like if you can make it into some sort of if you can add like lots of RPG elements into the game that's separate to PvP, then that would be great. That's what the Japanese players are asking for.
Yeah, so if I could roleplay as a Russian tank commander, that'd be really great.
Well, better crew skill training, the buildings, the base.
Let's stay on point,
better base.
Guys.
Can we get like a PvE raid element?
Guys. Just to sort of like touch on that. I mean, we are Obsidian, right? So we're known for RPGs. We're known for having that sort of like progression element to it. The progression elements in the game right now, in terms of retrofits, in terms of commanders and crew systems, are definitely not the final versions, and we definitely want them to feel more RPG-like in terms of the different types of ways to progress your commander. We're going to be reworking that system. We're reworking how crew works to give them a little bit more unique personalities and unique traits. So you actually have different types of crew that you can accrue over time. No pun intended. And so all those things are things that we are planning on implementing that will give you more of that sense of customization and personalization that are sort of like cornerstones to things that are like our RPG games. So yes,
at its core, Armored Warfare is always going to be a tank game, even if it has an RPG light elements to it. So,
no, nothing like that. Basically, what the Japanese player wants is that, let's say you go to one location where you talk to some NPC person,
then go play
and then...
a different game.
Exactly. Mm.
That's not what this game is.
Guys, hey.
Back on point.
Let's get back on point here. I mean, like, we do appreciate the suggestion there. I mean, we do get the point of what you mean about the RPG elements in terms of that. I mean, if I don't want to get too bogged down in this topic because, I mean, we're coming up on 80 minutes now. And, you know, yeah, I mean, we do appreciate the feedback. Don't get me wrong. It's just you can reach out to one of the community managers on a private level and give us more specific feedback of what you're talking about. But I mean, from an overall standpoint, I think we do understand what you mean in terms of not just having the smaller elements where it's just kind of but having like an overall feel of more of a MMO sort of missions and stuff like that. And definitely it's good feedback to get. And I don't want us to get too bogged down on this topic.
Okay. Yeah, I've been trying to get a question in for a while, but I keep getting talked over. So this is my first time here, and if I was a new player coming into this, I would have left a while ago. Except that I really like this game. So just take that from where we start here.
Like 80 people in this room.
Well, yeah, but there's 10 people that have dominated most of the conversation. Just.
No, so go ahead and talk.
But I just wanted to just say it. One of the things is one of the things with PvP is platooning. I like playing artillery, but if I platoon with an arty, I'll never get into a match. Is there a way to have it so you don't have to always have two arties in a match? You can just have one? Because after a while, you don't want to play arty anymore because you know you're never going to get into a match unless you play PvE. Maybe not, but it... You have to weigh balance over playability. If players can't get in, I like being part of battalion. I know a lot of people who play World of Tanks and other games, they don't want to be a part of battalion. They want to come in and play a game.
Artillery is balanced around counter battery, right? That's a major part of the gameplay.
Well, yeah.
If you completely eliminate that aspect of their gameplay, how's that fair for the other team that can be damaged with impunity?
Well, it's
they lost. Certainly, you do have a right to, you know, to play your tank, right? But when it ruins the experience of other players, it's better to play something else.
Arctic, uncue your mic when he's talking, please.
Okay, I'm sorry.
We're just getting a repeat there.
The fix on that particular issue, Arctic, is grow the player base.
Well, yeah, but how are you going to grow the player base if the people coming can't play the tanks they want to play?
Do we really want to start band-aiding that type of problem, though, or do we want to fix the problem in general?
Well,
that's very specific.
Well, I'm just saying, it's just one major problem, because if a person can't come in as an individual and play the vehicles they want to play, they're not going to stay, and the player base isn't going to grow.
Well, they can play the vehicles that they want to play. They just can't play the Arty. Like, that's a very specific form of vehicle. That's what I'm saying.
If we double the number of people playing PvP and the wait times go down, some of that type of problem might solve itself.
Well, yeah.
Look at
EU.
Look at
EU
population.
Well,
come join us on NA. Come join us on NA on Wednesdays and Fridays. We will match an artillery to the other queue part. We will spam artilleries if you want. Come join us.
No, but I'm just saying, is a lot of things have been battalion focused, and some people don't want to come being part of a battalion. They don't want to come in. They're not going to be waiting for all this stuff. They want to be able to play the game as they come in. They're not going to say, well, I need to wait for this time. And whatever. I mean, I'm just talking from an average person playing a game.
We can look into making it more flexible. That's something that we can look into.
I'm saying, like, 5 minutes or 3 minutes as an arty, if you haven't gotten in the game, kick an arty, allow an arty to get kicked in. I'm not saying over a 6x6 match, but maybe give it some time. If the person's not getting in, maybe have a parameter over a certain time. Okay, we're going to waive this requirement right now so this person can play his arty.
As we've said before, you're sacrificing game balance to let one person have their, you know, day in the sun.
Well, not sure again, that much of a game balance.
Mechanics involved with the matchmaker that also, for example, allow platoons to get into battles more easily when they've waited a long amount of time. So I don't really necessarily see that as an unreasonable request.
User
disconnected
from your channel. Yeah, especially
we can look into it.
Can we get this back on point? If we can use this time, if we can use this time to have players ask questions to the development team and the development team answer back, that's probably a better use of our time. Clans can talk to each other about these merits, you know, anytime. So let's use the valuable time of having Rich here and such answering questions directly to you and use it properly.
All right, here's one. Maps like Highwall and Coastal Threat, where roughly 70 to 80% of the map is not actually drivable, are those seen as good maps in any way, shape, or form towards any sort of play via PvP or PvE?
So Highwall is pretty much at the top of our list for a refactor. You know, ultimately we're not happy with how that one turned out, and we're aware of it. And the refactor is largely increasing the amount of playable space on the map, especially in the center area, taking down a lot of the plateau there and turning that into traversable terrain. Coastal Threat, I'm a little less sure on. It plays better with smaller teams, so it might stay as is and become more of a small team map. It's hard for me to say exactly what the future would be for that map, but Highwall is definitely a high priority refactor.
Are you trying to go in some way direction towards developing?
Yeah, can you speak about your new maps, Rich?
I think Frontline is a pretty big direction shift from the maps that we've been making before. So we'll really be looking at the feedback that we get on that. That's going to be coming up in .17.
Is that the one that's supposed to be more open?
It's large, it's open. You know, it's got routes on it, but the ability to cross between the routes is very, very easy, very open. There's just enough cover to get around the map. I think it's a lot closer in the direction that addresses a lot of the problems that's been had with a lot of our recent maps. So we're really looking forward to the feedback on that one.
If you guys want to actually see what those new maps are going to look like, we're going to have a developer live stream next week, and we'll have a couple preview videos of the two new maps that are coming out.
When are we going to start seeing more light tanks enter the game, or tank destroyers for that matter, as well as when are we going to start seeing perhaps rebalances for both of those classes?
I don't have the actual schedule sitting right in front of me in terms of like which vehicles are coming in on which, so I don't want to go into that too deeply other than to say like the next line of vehicles, probably double check here, make sure. One second.
Also picking on that, is the RDS ever going to get smoke like it said in the original release notes of 0.15?
It will get smoke, yes. It will get smoke. It should have gotten smoke in .15, and so we will be adding smoke to it, definitely.
Thank on that note, I think that tank's going to become OP once you add smoke to it.
Do you have any plans to expand artillery and tank destroyers to tier 10s?
Aren't we still answering the question from before, though?
Yeah, he's looking up channel. The answer to it.
So what was the question again? Artillery, right? In tank destroyers? In expanding those to tier 10, yes, definitely. Probably TD first before artillery. Tier 8 artillery is already really strong. And in fact, if we did add more artillery, we might actually consider taking the T8 artillery and moving that to T10, potentially. Just because they do represent some of the most modern artillery available. That being said, tank destroyers definitely sooner rather than later. And so we will definitely be expanding those to tier 10 and doing some more to sort of like get those lines more unique at the higher tiers.
Okay, thank you.
Taking a look at some of the upcoming vehicles, we do have a dedicated line of light tanks. I can't really give a date range on it right now. It is in our queue, but the actual artwork has not started on them yet, so that puts them out multiple ways.
From your channel.
The trick with light tanks in general is just like there aren't a lot of those compared to the other classes, so it's a little trickier for us to find ways to work those into the threes, but we definitely want to get more in there.
Sure.
On the questions on
like based on the CV90 hull, I get that.
We are going to make some. There are definitely more of those coming. On the topic of tier 10, yes, definitely, we are going to be getting TDs into tier 10. We're also looking at converting the Draco into a TD. It probably should have been released as a TD. That's really how it plays. It doesn't handle like an AFB. So there's very high likelihood that vehicle will actually be changing class in an upcoming patch. We just want to evaluate how we do that in a way that sort of, you know, doesn't screw people that picked it up because they wanted it as an AFB. But really, it is a TD, and it's going to become that role eventually.
Some of the stat when you do that?
Yeah, it would see a stat adjustment.
Oh, is there any possibility of filling in a lot of the gaps that we have with the SPGs anytime soon?
Nothing past 8. So it's not soon. I know that's unfortunate.
User joined your channel.
And now there's probably people that like artillery have probably collected the artillery vehicles that are there. We're still trying to get a handle on artillery as a class. And before we go and start adding more artillery, we really need to kind of make sure that we are 100% happy with where artillery is as a class. So our focus on artillery is more on the direction of mechanics and support shells and continue to balance and iterate on it rather than putting new artillery in. And that's kind of why there hasn't been
disconnected
new artillery
from your
on the
channel.
Plate since we got those first two lines in. So, like, I don't have an ETA for artillery. We do want to get new artillery in, but right now we don't want to add more artillery until we're happy with where it is in class.
Real quick, can we confirm that 0.16 is dropping next week?
Not definitely, but that's, you know.
That is the plan. Unless we encounter something that would be a showstopper, that's the current plan.
User joined your channel.
Thank you.
I have two questions, one for the devs and actually one for the MyCom guys. On the dev side, I've been having a lot of issues, and it might be my PC, but with disappearing shells. You fire them, you're broadside to a tank, and they just disappear. I believe a lot of people have complained. I've heard people complain. ATGMs do the same thing. Is that something that you're working on to fix, or do you know about it?
I've also seen ATGMs fire straight at a target, and all of a sudden they're about to hit, and they just do a complete 90-degree turn and hit the ground.
Yeah, I've experienced the same as well.
I've heard a lot of people complain about ATGMs in it, and they're just in zoomed out.
I've been in first-person mode when I've had it happen.
I don't play a lot of the missile tanks, and for the most part, I don't use ATGMs in my MBTs. And it's a lot of the MBTs. I'll fire at something, and shot will look like a little hit, and you'll get no indication, and it just disappears.
Have you been seeing that in version .15?
Yes.
Yep.
There is a ghost shell issue currently. It's not quite often, but it is often enough to be extremely annoying.
Happened
I would say
at least.
Hear
me
screaming at him all night. I would say that comes at least once a game.
Wouldn't that just tie into the shot delay?
No,
I don't think so. That doesn't sound like shot delay.
Are they really ghost shells, or are they just missing the tank because the shot was delayed?
Flat out ghost shells.
Can we get replays of these? Since that would help development a lot, I would think.
I've got several of them. If you want me to upload them to the support forum.
So the thing with replays is that. If possible, making a video out of the replay is better, just for the simple fact that obviously getting them to us is great too, but as soon as we go to the next patch, those replays are going to be sort of nullified because it's a new version. So getting both the replay to us with the accompanying file and potentially a YouTube video of the exact moment where the issue occurs helps us cross-reference and actually like dial in what could have possibly happened there.
I can sort that out here this evening and get that all set up.
Well, appreciate it. What's your follow-up my.com question? Go ahead.
So my other question is, there's all this talk about getting players from different games to come in and giving them incentives. Is there any plans like a loyalty incentive for those of us who have been here faithfully since, you know, open beta back in October, and some of the guys that have been here even during, you know, the closed early access.
Enough to have 4 tier 10s.
Or those of us that are stuck with this and haven't given up.
In my case.
Sure, I mean, are you guys looking at, like, I mean, we're going to have, are you looking for, like a one-year anniversary thing or that kind of stuff, just
I'll
rewards over time?
I'll take it.
I might be able to swing you a million credits. I'm not sure about a million gold.
I'll take a recam of Starship.
With my name on it.
To be
anniversary gift sounds good. You know, that sounds good. Like you've been here for 6 months and you get this, and or, you know.
Well,
and
yeah. On that tank, note.
Special skin like that.
Exactly. On that note, how about an exclusive tank?
The IS-8.
Exclusive tank.
Tanks are pretty unpopular. To be perfectly honest, just because you know, people will always come later.
I'd be happy with it.
I just want to say I want a golden swing fire.
Well, not
it's called a swag fire,
tag, but maybe
yeah, the
swag fire. The Terminator, like you did the Terminator in the.
Okay, yeah, I got you. So you want a veterans program? Let me see what we can do. I would say that the first opportunity to reward veterans would probably be at our 1 year. So let me look in to see what we can provide at that time.
Hey guys, just to jump in here, Grizz, you had a question that you wanted to ask, right?
Yeah, real quick. Touching back on putting information into the launcher or forums or whatever, where in priority for like, fixing is the chat in-game and in the garage? Because you guys redid the whole garage UI, but global chat is extremely limited, and it's sorted up between 1, 2, and 3 sometimes, and with the spamming and stuff, there's so many, it's a very archaic system. I'm just wondering when we'll see a new chat system. Because if we get a good chat system implemented, that'll really help everybody coordinate in-game instead of having to go back to the launcher or forums or anything like that. Right now, you can't even change what channel you're in to talk to everybody.
No, I agree. Improving the chat system has been a UI priority for us a long time. It's basically on our top 10 list. Problem is, just other things keep beating it into the top 10. I wish I had an ETA on it. It's something I've been pushing for internally for probably 6 months now. There's only so many UI programmers, and unfortunately, it's been hard to get that one to be the absolute top thing on the list for them to get onto. I wish I had a better answer than that. Other than I 100% agree, I definitely want to improve the chat system significantly.
Is there any kind of projected date for when the game would actually leave beta and go into formal release?
This year.
Really?
So sometime before the end of your calendar year?
That's the tentative plan right now, yes.
Cool, thanks.
Hey guys, just heads up.
Frost, you're pretty quiet, bud.
No resets, no.
No resets, no, absolutely not. Just heads up, guys, we're going to close this down in about 10 minutes, so just try to get your questions in. And if not, if you have any questions that we miss, you're welcome to hit us up privately, but we're going to close it off in 10 minutes.
I have a question. What type of tank lines can we expect to be seeing here in the next coming patches, if any, for the Zhangfang line? Because they've only got currently the MBT line, and that only goes to tier 8 from tier 3. User disconnected from your channel.
Rich, you want to touch on that?
Upcoming tank lines?
Zhangfang.
Zhangfang tank lines.
I just closed all my notes. I apologize. User disconnected from your channel. So, the next main block is to add a bunch of Eastern European vehicles to Fang. We also want to finish out the Chinese MVP line. So those will be kind of the two sections of vehicles that will be coming up in the patches of introducing line.
Okay, cool.
What about the French line? User disconnected from your channel. The Leclerc and a lot of other fighting vehicles as well. User joined your channel. Waiting for.
The French line is being developed.
All right.
Those are actively in development right now, so you can anticipate them coming up fairly soon after the next two lines.
Are we looking at getting the AMX line in 0.16, or is that in a future patch?
No, the AMX line is not coming in 0.16. The only vehicles that are going to be in 0.16 are the ones that Silent Stalker posted on the forum. User
disconnected premiums. From your channel.
Yeah, 0.16 does not have a lot of new vehicles in it.
What sort of things are you guys looking at to balance light tanks?
So light tanks. That continues to be probably the trickiest non-artillery class to get into the right place. We really do want them to handle better mobility-wise. One of the things at the top of our list right now is a mobility pass for light tanks. We feel like they lose too much speed when turning. It really hurts trying to get in flank when you start end up losing all that mobility when you start navigating.
Actually resemble MVTs from, I think, like the EA 2 and 3 phase. They drop down like nobody's business, or they just don't.
Yeah, and that's the top priority for right now for light tanks, is do a pass on that. We are also probably for .17, maybe even potentially as a .16 balance update. We're also just going over them. This won't be a global buff to all light tanks, but we are looking at individual light tanks for a health buff to bring them up closer to the MBT range. There are a few light tanks where we don't think that's maybe necessary, but there are ones where we think it will also help.
Is it a
help.
Consideration to perhaps undo the pen buff and perhaps go about adding a little more armor to the front of light tanks? Because right now the PL-01, the Begleitpanzer, and the VFM all feel really great, right? The VFM sees extensive use in competitive play, but like tanks like the Stingray,
it dies too quickly to AFVs, right? It won't matter how much HP you give it if it doesn't have armor in the front to bounce Vibbles or whatever AFV. It won't matter how much HP you add to it; it'll still be garbage.
Right. I would anticipate. So we are working on basically an overall, like I mentioned earlier, sort of looking at the power curve, looking at power growth. One of the areas that we'll probably see some pretty significant adjustments as this plan comes together is penetration overall, and how that plays off of the different armor channel thicknesses. One of the challenges has been essentially penetration. It largely doesn't matter because either you're going to target places that you'll always pen or the other places you can't pen. So penetration is a balanced parameter, is not in an interesting place right now anyway. So penetration is likely to see some changes. Autocannons are also, like, that's kind of the direction that we would likely be looking at is the autocannon DPM and the penetration in general on autocannons. Is that really where it should be for the class and how those engagements play out? I don't know that we would necessarily add a lot more armor to the front of light tanks. I could see a potential for a buff there on some of those, but I don't know that it would necessarily be a game changer for the light tanks that don't already have it. I wouldn't say that we won't do that, but it's something we're thinking about, but it's not really part of the current trajectory for them.
Well, I mean, it's mainly autocannon fire that's the problem with only a select amount of those light tanks. Like, you're not going to go against a VFM in an autocannon and win that, more times than not. You're not going to do it in a PL01, but you can do it in a Stingray, no problem.
So, to be entirely fair, it's not just those specific light tanks. It's also the TDs that get absolutely shredded by it as well. That's
I do feel the problem is actually the autocannons. I think autocannons are sort of they're more effective in higher DPM than they really should be. I don't want to go and say, well, we should just globally nerf AFVs and autocannons across the board, but there are some gameplay concerns there. I feel the time to kill on autocannons across the board right now is more effective than it should be. We do want to make sure that the class stays viable, but I also feel that right now TDs and long tanks are just getting dominated by them too much. User disconnected
from your channel. So how about the light tank ability? Where do you guys feel you are on that? And I know you just did the buff, the length of time buff from like 5 seconds to 7 seconds. But we were more, I think the community was more looking for like a severity buff, because like some tanks, especially like the Sheridan, you hit that buff and it's just like nothing happens.
Yeah, we definitely intend to continue improving that. Because of the window of time where that change went internally for about 16, we decided to be a little bit more conservative on this pass for it. But the light tank ability should continue to see some improvements, potentially in .17. The important thing is that it's noticeable, right? Like, there's no point to a class mechanic that when you activate it, you can't tell that it did anything. So that's definitely something we'll be targeting.
Did you possibly think of switching the ability from, instead of speed, to taking light tank accuracy back to the way they were in the early access phase, where if you hit the ability, you get no bloom whatsoever on, like, any hull or turret movement?
We have talked about that. It is not off the table. That actually has been part of the conversations about the light tank ability in general. I don't have a decision on that right now, but it is possible.
Hey guys, about a class ability as well.
Sorry guys, just to jump in here, just two more questions. So this will be this question and then one question after that, and then we're going to close up.
You all had mentioned in some of your earlier communications that one of the things that was being looked at was the class ability for TDs for gun suppression. What kind of data are you seeing in its usage? Personally, I play TDs on a regular basis, and I can literally count on one hand how many times I've actually used the actual ability.
Right. That actually was our observation as well. We actually tracked, just to kind of give an idea of sort of the data we were looking at for it. We track people using it. We also track, we kind of considered it you know, failure state. So it, like, a user activated the class ability but barely did anything with it. Common failure state did end up being the fact that it was canceled when you moved. That was probably one of the majority of the problems that we saw in attempts to, you know, someone's actually trying to use this ability, but they got nothing out of it. That is why you'll see in the .16 patch notes, we've taken a lot of the restrictions out of the Tank Destroyer class ability. You can now use it on the move. There's now no penalty. You know, you can be stopped, you can be started, or mobile when you activate it. I believe we also adjusted the cooldown and the duration in .16 as well. And we kind of wanted to stop there and let players try it without all the restrictions and see if that feels like it's in a better place before we decide if there's going to be any further changes to it. But yeah, definitely our analysis showed the same thing. No one was using it. I think that we looked at a week's worth of data on the North America server, and I think it had been used like 5 times the entire week. So we totally recognized that that was not working as an ability. But we do want to give it a shot with these changes and see if that improves it. If it doesn't, we'll go back to the drawing board on it.
How about the time in between shots? That restriction, did you adjust that as well? Like, to where if you don't shoot a shot after like 2 seconds, I think it is, the ability cancels?
It's about 4 seconds. We haven't adjusted that.
Okay.
You can actually see the preliminary patch notes on the main general section of the forum. It'll detail all the changes we did to the Tank Destroyer ability. From your channel.
All right, guys, last question.
Yeah.
Who's up?
Question. Italian. And they're right now pretty much about the only thing that battalions have going for them is, yeah, you're hanging out together with your buds and you get to drop. Something needs to be done where, like, we can get new bros in battalions and trade off the lower tier tanks when new guys grind up to a new tank instead of having to purchase a newer tank, and some tax system.
Maybe like a rental system, you mean?
Yeah, where the battalion can lend a tank out, or it goes to that person, and then it can be put back in a battalion garage, and you could have like either a battalion garage, or because in EVE Online, I can give anything to anybody at any point, but here I can't help anybody new out unless I did help a couple of new people out. I got them a humble bundle with when the humble bundle event was going on. So
maybe like an battalion base. Channel.
Yeah. Something like that, Titan.
Or like an armor. Yeah, that's a really good idea.
That is a good idea.
I like it too.
Spish, give me everything.
Exactly.
Thank you for your comment.
That is
the battalion base.
I doubt there'll be anyone against the idea. It is tricky, so. You know, we do have a largely closed economy, you know, which is why you can't auction your stuff off or trade into other players. We'd have to be very careful before we open the door to breaking that paradigm, essentially, that of trying to keep this closed economy where every player is sort of their own resources or their own pool of credits and XP. I'm not opposed to that idea. Going back to the original concept, original concern about battalions and why, you know, why should you even be one? That is definitely a problem. We need to find more reasons why players would want to be in a battalion. What's the rewards for? What's the incentives? There are a lot of different approaches to that. There are a lot of games where you sort of have kind of the battalion rank up systems with different rewards for the battalions. I think those are kind of cool, but they also tend to be very short-lived as a feature because, you know, you get in those large battalions that max those out, and, you know, within 4 or 5 months, they hit the top of whatever ladder there is to level up a battalion, and then it's not really a feature anymore. It's just sort of something they ground through really quickly. So there's potential there, but it has to be done right in a way that's actually interesting, that doesn't screw the small battalions, but it's also perpetually interesting for a large battalion. So that's kind of an idea to float around. In the immediate near future, certainly for Lords of War, one of the things that probably hasn't actually been mentioned in any of the documentation, I'd have to double check. You can flag teams as a battalion team, so your battalion tag shows up next to the team name. So when you start, you know, climbing the ratings and getting your name on the board and everything like that, you do get some bragging rights for the battalion that you're a part of there. I know that's not like a big deal, but it's sort of just a little bit of getting your name out there as a battalion, which I think is helpful in that direction. but we totally recognize that there needs to be more for battalion membership to be rewarded for. But at this point, I'd say like there's nothing concrete other than to say that, you know, we are of course looking at larger scale battalion type conflicts as well.
I'm just saying that even if it was just the bare tank, you know, and they can't take the tank and use it until they can't even get it out of the battalion garage until they can use the ground through that the previous tier for that tank. They have to meet the requirements to be able to sit in the tank. You know, we all have all those requirements.
Sure.
So I just think that being able to take a tank out of the garage, and if they can't sell it, they'd have to put it back in the battalion garage.
No, it's an interesting idea. Like I said before, like that wouldn't be off the table. It's just something that we'd have to approach very carefully.
I would say let's take out of the garage, but as an available resource to the battalion.
Or maybe they could look at the setup, like what retrofits, what crew and whatnot it has.
Alright guys, is that, I think that's about everything.
Yeah, thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, thank you everybody for attending. We really appreciate it. We're definitely going to do more of these. You know, thank you to Rich and to Spunky and to Josh for taking the time to be here and answering all your questions. We really appreciate it. Thank you guys. And thank you to all of you for participating. You know, you guys are what make the game great, and we really appreciate that you took the time to come here and talk to us, and we hope you'll make it back next time. So,
yeah, thanks, everyone. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, guys, really.
Big thanks from the players, too. Like, it's an awesome opportunity to be able to have direct contact with you guys, you know, the ones that are solely responsible for this game.
Yeah, thanks,
man.
Drop it.
Yeah, I mean, user disconnected
from your channel. Yeah, definitely. I mean, these sort of events are kind of our favorite thing to do. Being able to talk to you
guys, I'm gonna end this video here because there's no more questions and stuff.
And stuff like that.
And
I think
check out
like, it really makes a big difference to be able to have a conversation in real time. And we definitely, you know, we will.